whole picture is an absolute collection of every technique you could ever think of. There were lots of different types of explosions. We had lots of standard, like, fire explosions. As it was night, they had to be fiery type explosions to register.
Those charges were made up with a black powder lifting charge and ignition, and with petrol, gasoline, so it comes up and you get the explosions.
Whereas in the desert at the end, those were meant to be sonic explosions, so you didn't actually have flame in them. They were eruptions of the desert.
Yeah, there was stuff when we were in the desert where we shot the whole battle sequence. Everybody had their stations to look where the explosions were going to be.
We had markers, so we knew from the camera position where the explosions were, and for the stuntmen, so they knew. But of course, when we shot the thing, you can't have sticks.
You have to have people on buttons, and they've got their eye on a spot, and a person has got to hit that spot. If you miss that timing, you're ruined.
You don't let something off because it's meant to go off at that moment of time if there's somebody too close to it, no matter what the director might say afterwards.
The attack on the palace, that was the nearest thing to a sort of standard war picture with bombs going off, I mean, explosions, fire, smoke, black smoke. I mean, David was insistent on black smoke. Everybody was covered in smoke. We're talking about 20 years ago where there's a lot of things we used to do. We're certainly not allowed to burn rubber tires anymore for environmental purposes, but that was the only way we could get our sky full of black smoke, black enough for David. We had a tremendous amount of wire work on Dune in one form or another, right down from the very fine wires with the hunter seeker, the little thing. But that, we had to turn it and it had to turn around and go back. We didn't have wire removal. We didn't have the facility of wire removal, so they had to be infinitesimal, like tungsten wires it was floated on.
Tungsten steel wires, which were micro-thin, 0.0, which come from England, and they are anodized. They are, instead of being shiny silver, they're sort of blackened.
The glow globes that were flying around on wires had radio control inside so that one could switch the lights on and off, and I think we could dim them as well. There was no actual feed cables to the glow globes. And to get round us, we had Harley-Davidson motorcycle batteries inside that made the things very heavy, and lots of 100-watt quartz bulbs, which gave them a fairly short running time. But it worked. I remember the scenes. I think on some of them we had quite a lot of rain as well, which always goes well with electricity. Keeps it cool.
In the scene where the Baron gets very excited and punches his chest, which causes him to levitate rapidly into the air, he flies up about 20, 25 feet. Basically, I was the man on the counterweight system, which through a series of pulleys and harnesses allowed the Baron to make this rapid levitation effect. And then he begins to fly down, and there it's a cut. They cut to another set and another apparatus. He goes to a ground-based parallelogram where he's basically standing on a platform, and then the parallelogram arm is swung into place underneath the shower head. There would be no way for wires to work because they'd interfere with the shower assembly. An additional challenge was the Baron flying around this shower of steam. That was an entirely different rig that I conceived and built specifically for that scene and that scene only. The Baron had to make several revolutions around the shower. Basically, it was an arm like this, and there was a wheel assembly here with the ability to drop wires down to attach to the Baron. This part swiveled, and this whole arm swiveled. The operator sat on a chair and held onto a steering wheel and basically pulled himself around very much like the teacup ride at Disneyland.
Just one thing that I spent probably 3 months, 4 months nearly, building was the fighting robot, where Kyle actually, he learns to fight.
They wanted it to do everything, wanted it to be convincingly attacking him all the time.
Activate a fighter.
The actual robot, not only did it have to come down and travel round, the robot itself had to rotate itself, suspended on that rail that sends it round and round. And then built into it was like a knife thing that flies out at him. It fired darts, There was a big spear concertina thing that had to come in and out.
A pneumatic ram with one movement through a linkage system that produced the scissor action of the knife coming out from the robot. The darts were an easier one to do, that's just compressed air. It was very powerful. I mean, it would hurt you if they got caught on it. It was their skills that had to overcome all that.
Precise control. Looking back on the whole film, it was a cutting edge at the time, whereas nowadays you think, well, everybody does that.
I tell you, it was a great experience, that movie, because it could have been disastrous. It was so much in it.
It was a lot of work, but at the end of the day, it all comes together and creates the illusion you see on the screen.
Hey, now don't close out, I've got some awesome movie extra trivia. One of the great pioneers of special effects was Ray Harryhausen. He pushed the limits of imagination, visual effects and miniatures in ways that inspired generations after him. One of his most famous moments in film was a scene in Jason and the Argonauts, where the hero had a sword fight with 7 skeleton warriors. The scene was done with stop motion and took 4 months to complete. Now, do you like my shirt? You can get one for yourself in the shop section under the video.